After leaving, fleeing Tibet, the Lamas were put into an internment camp called Baksadur in northern India. But Lama Zopa Rinpoche had TB, and they thought it best that he go to Darjeeling, where the Baksadur camp was very hot, very difficult. They've just arrived in Darjeeling, is where we take up this story. Some months after Thubten Yeshe and Zopa Rinpoche's arrival, a tall, glamorous Western woman turned up at Samten Choling. This was Zina Rachevsky, then aged 36. Zina's father, Vladimir Rachevsky, had been a member of the court of Tsar Nicholas II, the last Russian Tsar, in St. Petersburg. Vladimir and his entire family were commoners, not nobility, though Vladimir's sister, also called Zinaida, married into royalty when she wed the Grand Duke Boris, Tsar Nicholas's brother. At the time of the Russian Revolution, the family had escaped to Europe and settled in a big house, Sans Souci, on the French Riviera. Vladimir was penniless. In France, he met and married Harriet Strauss, daughter of Chicago banker and real estate millionaire S.W. Strauss. Their only child, Zinaida, was born in Paris in 1930. 2 years later, the Strauss fortune collapsed and Harriet's inheritance disappeared along with it. Later, Zina recalled her earliest years at Sans Souci as the happiest of her life, even though her parents separated when she was still a child. Vladimir remained on the Riviera while Harriet moved to the Virgin Islands, leaving Zina in New York with her maternal grandmother. She was a wild child and not easy for the grandmother to manage. Zina grew up to be an extraordinarily beautiful young woman with thick golden hair, skin like cream, flashing almond eyes and a rosebud mouth. Spoiled and precocious, she spent some of her childhood in Hollywood, where she became a celebrity starlet. Her name appeared in the headlines a number of times for her wild antics and in connection with several drug scandals. At the end of World War II, she rushed to Paris to join her father, who had become the quintessential penniless bouvardier. Zina did not flinch at the prospect of having to support herself. She appeared in a number of B-grade movies, worked as a stripper at the Crazy Horse Saloon, sang a duet with Maurice Chevalier, and posed for designer Jacques Haim in a crowd-stopping fig leaf bikini on the Place de la Concorde.
Thank you. lost and lonely you, strange as angels dancing in the...
Zina floated among some of the most fascinating people in Western society on both sides of the Atlantic. She hung out with beat poets Gregory Corso, Allen Ginsberg, Jack Kerouac and others. Rubbed elbows with Russian nobility in exile and knew many influential members of the New York and European arts and cinema scene. From a wild child, she had become an outrageous young woman, and her escapades were perfect fodder for gossip magazines. In 1948, when Zina was 18, she married Count Bernard d'Harcourt, a descendant of Louis-Philippe I, the King of France. To celebrate, they gave a fabulous Venetian ball in Hollywood. The marriage lasted just 1 year. She soon married again, this time an American, Bill Barker. That marriage also failed. In the 1950s, she married another American, Conrad Rooks. Show me how you do that trick, the one that makes me scream, he said. The one... An aspiring filmmaker and heir to the Avon fortune. Conrad and Zina had a son together, Alexander. Zina and Conrad kept a house on the Greek island of Mykonos, where the couple and their son spent a few months every year.
There was someone also watching us from a cafe. It turned out to be an American woman named Zina. And after the 10 days were through, I'm going back to Athens. I got back on a ferry boat. I was up on the top deck and there was almost no one on board. But there was this one woman who was this very striking, beautiful blonde woman, a little bit older than myself. And she came to me and said hello to me and said she noticed me in these street scenes, that she would watch us because this group of friends would always be with each other. And we got talking. And she happened to be someone who claimed to be Princess Zina Rachevsky, a Russian princess. So she really wasn't a Russian princess. She was from Brooklyn, a Jewish girl. But she, her father was from Russia, and evidently he had been in the guards of the Tsar or something, and was indirectly related to some nobility. So she just took upon herself to say, and she looked gorgeous. Now she was tall, 5'9", 5'10", blonde hair, enormous blue eyes, and a really beautiful face, very dramatic. And she had been a part-time actress in Athens, in Italy. And she had been on various magazines, like not quite Playboy, but Rogue, and these kind of, she, in some layouts, because she was this actress. And she had married some guy named Conrad Rooks, who was making a film, in, or going to make a film, about his life as an addict. and he had just gone to France and taken a peyote cure for his addictions, and then once had overcome with a psychiatrist, and then he went to India, to Ceylon, and was studying yoga and had really overcome his addiction, and he was going to come back to Athens where he lived with Zina. So, you know, it was a very interesting story. She knew all sorts of writers, and Allen Ginsberg and Kerouac, and these people her husband knew, who was wealthy and so forth. So it was fascinating talking to this woman, so I got her name, her address, and on her telephone number. And when I got home to Greece, to Athens, I wrote her a letter, and I asked her if we could meet in the Parthenon on the Acropolis. You know, so she did send me a card back, because I had my address, and she said, I still have that card. And she said, you know, you sound very like Walt Whitman, Song of the Open Road. You know, there must be a pure form of expression. I cannot meet at the Temple of Athena. And she gave her address and her telephone number. So I called her up, and she invited me to a party. So that was, and then soon after I did go to meet with Aaliyah Kazan and got a part-time job in this film. And then I met a whole other group of people, Eli and Charlene, who was there, and my other friends. And then Eli and Charlene and Zina and Conrad, when Conrad came back from Ceylon, all got together, and that was sort of the basis of this community that I got together with.
Then Zina became pregnant to another man. While Alexander remained in Greece with his father, Zina moved to their house in Kandy, Ceylon, where she gave birth to a daughter, Rhea. Throughout all this, Zina was known everywhere as Princess Rachevsky, which was stretching things rather a lot. However, Princess Rachevsky, she remained. Babe in arms, she returned to Greece, where she fell in love with German actor Nikolaus Dutschke. Quote, "We were both immediately attracted to each other," said Nikolaus. "Zina, the Russian princess hippie queen with this little baby, trying to find a place where she could hide, come down, somehow get away from it all and rest. She wanted to leave immediately for India, but I was successful at the time, driving around in Jaguar cars and having responsibilities. I couldn't just up and leave." Zina was very unhappy. Her wealth had gone. Her figure had changed a lot after the second pregnancy, and her close friend Nina Dyer had died mysteriously the year before. We have a footnote on Nina Dyer. She was a beautiful Anglo-Indian model and a dear friend of Zina. She had first married Baron Hans Heinrich Tyson Bornemisza, one of Europe's richest men, in 1954. And then Prince Sadruddin Aga Khan in 1957. Their marriage lasted until 1962. In July of 1965, she was found dead with an empty sleeping pill bottle beside her. There was no suicide note. When Nikolaus returned to Berlin, Zina wrote to him from Athens. "The apartment is darkened by curtains, Rolling Stones on the radio, and the hiccup of my daughter, Rhea. I get out on the streets to escape the tourist crowds, only to find the walls of my inner chaos, which I cannot escape from. 2 days after you left, I swallowed 6 sleeping pills, waking in tears and hysteria, wondering when the nightmare would end, if it would ever end. Determined that this time the karma of my Western life will not be repeated if ever I make it out of here. Go east, Zina. Nicholas, if we meet in the east, there will be so much time. Zinaida. Zina went back to Kandy to visit Conrad Rooks. He told her she might find a teacher in Darjeeling. Zina had played around with fashionable witch covens in Paris and had almost certainly read Govinda's Way of the White Clouds, which was a very popular book written by a German monk and published in 1966. Before going to Darjeeling, Zina first went to see the imposing head of the Kagyu lineage, the 16th Gyawa Karmapa, at his monastery in Rumtek, Sikkim. Overcome, she collapsed in tears at his feet. The Karmapa held her hand and gently told her to go to Darjeeling and find Domo Geshe Rinpoche. On arriving in Darjeeling, Zina took up residence in the hotel Windamere with Rhea.
Windamere is one of the oldest colonial property of India in the Himalayas. It is situated on Observatory Hill, a Darjeeling landmark believed to be the focus and repository of life-enhancing cosmic energies. Established in the 19th century as a cozy boarding house for bachelor English and Scottish tea planters, it was converted into a hotel just before the outbreak of the Second World War. Well known to sophisticated travelers the world over, the Windamere is famous for its unique ambience and charm and has been the subject of many leading stories in the international media.
In April, while strolling on the terrace dressed from head to toe in black leather, she met Jean Smith, an American scholar who had been part of Lowell Thomas's expedition to Buxar. Now we have a note on Jean Smith, 1936 to 2010, a highly respected Tibetologist. He worked for many years as a field director of several overseas offices of the US Library of Congress, and in 1999 founded the Tibetan Buddhist Resource Center, which is now called the Buddhist Digital Resource Center and is located in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Quote, "We both knew people from the scandalous London set of Christine Keeler and Mandy Rice Davies and became friends," said Jean. Now, Christine Keeler and Mandy Rice Davies were a couple of well-connected London showgirls. In 1961, Keeler had an affair with John Profumo, the Secretary of War, which when it came to light in 1963, brought down the government. Jean continues, "There was this wonderful old lady, Mrs. Brewster, who sat downstairs at the Hotel Windamere, making sure everyone was suitably dressed in the evenings. But Zina wouldn't behave at all. Then in May, she rented the lower floor of a house, Villa Altamont. The tenants upstairs looked after the Darjeeling Zoo. Zina told me she was looking for a teacher and believed she was the reincarnation of Madame Helena Blavatsky. She was a Russian-born spiritualist who in 1875 was one of the main founders of the Theosophical Society. Her work is considered the first example of what we now call New Age thinking. She had all her books and carried at least one of them everywhere she went. I gave her a list of names and addresses of lamas and monasteries in the region, and she got busy visiting, crossing them off at an alarming rate. The Hotel Windamere was run by some rather elegant Tibetans. The head of the family, Rai Bahadur Tendufla, headed the management committee of Gum Monastery. It was he who had arranged for Thubten Yeshe and Zopa Rinpoche to stay at Gum with the assistance of the Bengal Commissioner North, an Armenian called Ivan Surita. Quote, Zina asked me to accompany her on her excursions. She had already met most of the Kagyu and Nyingma lamas in the area, so she discussed with Tendufla where we should go next, said Jean. He suggested she visit Gum as there were two very good teachers there. It was a beautiful Sunday when Zina met the monks for the first time. Accompanying Jean and Zina was Jampa Gyaltsen Mutuk Tsang, a married Kagyu Lama whom Zina had found to translate for her. I took her everywhere to see everyone, he said. She wore a Western dress with lots of jewellery and asked many questions. I knew Zopa Rinpoche from the Young Lama's home school, where we had spent 6 or 7 months together. She knew she wasn't meeting Domo Geshe Rinpoche, though at school we had always called Zopa Rinpoche Domo Rinpoche because he had come from that monastery. I never heard him called Zopa until I met Westerners. Rinpoche invited us in and offered tea. The first thing Zina saw when the door opened was tiny Zopa Rinpoche looking up from his painting. She introduced herself and said she was looking for a Dharma teacher. At first she didn't see Thubten Yeshe, who was meditating in a corner of the dark room. Suddenly, he called to Zopa in Tibetan. Who is she? What does she want? Rinpoche replied that she was seeking enlightenment. Thubten Yeshe was astounded to hear a Westerner express such a sentiment. The general attitude among Tibetans was that Westerners were unable to understand Dharma and teaching them was a waste of time. Zopa Rinpoche had met Westerners before while at the Young Lama's home school, where the young tulkus had often visited Western embassies in Delhi, but neither monk had ever met anyone like Zina. Zopa Rinpoche called for tea, which duly arrived, a big monastery kettle of salty Tibetan butter tea. A big mug of it was poured for Zina, who drank it all immediately. Quote, that was the first time she had ever drunk Tibetan tea. I don't recall her ever drinking it again, said Rinpoche. Years later, Lama Yeshe recalled the day. So there we were. One morning, a monk knocked at our door and said, Lama Zopa's friend has come to see him. It was Zina Rachevsky, a Russian-American woman who was supposed to be a princess or something. She said she'd come to the East seeking peace and liberation, and asked me how they could be found. I was kind of shocked because I'd never expected Westerners to be interested in liberation or enlightenment. For me, that was a first. I thought, this is something strange, but very special. Of course, I did have some idea of what Westerners were, but obviously it was a Tibetan projection. So despite my surprise, I thought I should check to see if she was really sincere or not. I started to answer her questions as best I could, according to my ability. But after an hour, she said she had to go back to where she was staying in Darjeeling. However, as she was leaving, she asked, "Can I come back tomorrow?" So I said, "All right." Quote, "Zina liked the atmosphere and asked some questions about Buddhism," recounted Jean. Rinpoche answered very well, so she wanted to see him again. He agreed because since he was convalescing, he had some spare time. But Zina needed help. Rinpoche's English was not good enough, and Thubten Yeshe didn't speak any English at all. So two or three times a week, I'd hire a jeep and we'd spend an hour or two with them. They were always together, but Zina only spoke with Zopa Rinpoche because, being a tulku, he sat on a higher seat. Also, he spoke some English. Quote, "She came into our room like a thunderstorm," said Zopa Rinpoche, "full of energy and enthusiasm, and talking sharp sense about some high things and completely complicated nonsense about others. Most of her questions were about astral trips and psychic powers and those things." Zina began visiting the monks every morning at 9 o'clock, bringing new questions every time. One day she came with a rock on which the Buddha of Compassion's mantra, Om Mani Padme Hum, had been carved. "What is this for?" she asked. Another day she brought prayer flags. "Explain these. Why did Tibetans do this?" After 2 or 3 hours, she left in the jeep. Zina always brought along her daughter Ria, who wasn't even a year old, but left her in the jeep with her Nepalese nanny during these.
No complaints and no regrets. I still believe in chasing dreams and placing bets. For I have learned that all you give is all you get. So give it all you've got. I had my share, I drank my fill, and even though I'm satisfied, I'm hungry still to see what's down another road beyond the hill and do it all again. So here's to life and every joy it brings. Funny how the time just flies. How love can go from warm hellos to sad goodbyes and leave you with the memories you've memorized to keep your winters warm. For there's no yes in yesterday, and who knows what tomorrow brings or takes away. As long as I'm still in the game, I wanna play for laughs, for life, for love. So here's to life and every joy it brings. Here's to life, to dreamers and their dreams. May all ill storms be weathered, and all that's good get better. Here's to life, here's to love, here's to you.
C'est étrange. Je ne sais pas ce qui m'arrive ce soir. Je te regarde comme pour la première fois.
Encore des mots, toujours des mots, les mêmes mots.
Je ne sais plus comment te dire.
Rien que des mots.
Mais tu es cette belle histoire d'amour que je ne cesserai jamais de lire.
Des mots faciles, des mots fragiles, c'était trop beau.
Tu es d'hier et de demain.
Bien trop beau.
De toujours. Seule vérité.
Mais c'est fini, le temps des rêves. Les souvenirs se fanent aussi quand on les oublie.
Tu es comme le vent qui fait chanter le violon et emporte au loin le parfum des roses.